This video is sponsored by Conflict of Nations, the free online strategy game where you get to find out what it's like to take control of a real country and lead it in a modern global warfare. Set in the late 20th and early 21st century, Conflict of Nations lets you bring the most modern military technology to the battlefield to crush your enemies. But it isn't all about steamrolling your opponents in battle. I love that you also have to manage your country's economic efficiency if you want to get a technological edge over the other players. There's a deep military research tree that features over 250 different items to research, and if you manage it right, you'll soon be bringing weapons of mass destruction to the field that will terrify your foes. Infographics Show viewers get a special gift of 13,000 gold and 1 month of premium subscription for free when they use the link, but it's only available for 30 days. So click the link, choose a country, and start fighting your way to victory right now. Leonard Rifle sits in a lab working on his latest invention. Suddenly, the doors burst open and a heavily decorated Air Force general walks in. "Professor Rifle, we have a mission for you," says the general. "We're gonna nuke the moon, and you're gonna help us." Rifle can't believe what he just heard. "We're gonna what?" he asks. "Nuke the moon," responds the general. The Soviets launched Sputnik 1, the first satellite to go into space, on October 4th. It can be heard on radios around the world. "The United States is losing the space race, Professor, and we need to do something big to assert our dominance. What better way to show the world how powerful we are than blowing up the moon?" Rifle looks at the general suspiciously and asks, "Why would nuking the moon make a difference? Can the United States just land a craft on the lunar surface to collect data?" The general releases a long breath and pulls out a newspaper. It is the November 1st, 1957 issue of the Pittsburgh Post-Gazette. One of the headlines says, "Latest red rumor, they'll bomb the moon." Rifle lets out a whistle. "So, you guys weren't the first to think of this, I see." Rifle keeps reading the article, which talks about how the Soviet Union is planning to launch an H-bomb at the moon. However, the biggest concern is that the missile will miss its target and boomerang back around to strike the Earth. This is a matter of real concern, as it could turn the Cold War hot and kill millions of people. It seems that the Soviets' plan is no secret either. As they have told the world, they'll let everyone know when the launch is scheduled. That way, billions of people could look to the sky and watch as a nuclear bomb was detonated on the face of the moon by the USSR. "We need to beat the Soviets to the punch," the general says. "We need you to gather your colleagues at the Chicago's Armor Research Foundation and form a team to assess whether it's possible for the United States to launch a nuke to the moon and hit it. Also, we need to know what people here on Earth will be able to see. We cannot let the Soviets be the first to nuke the moon, not after they beat us by putting the first satellite into space. Get it done." The general turns around and exits the lab. Rifle is left staring at the closed door of the lab. "How the hell are we supposed to nuke the moon?" he shouts at the empty room. "I'm gonna need some help." Rifle begins gathering a team of engineers and scientists together to help him solve the problem of getting a nuclear warhead to the moon. But more importantly, he needs the brain power to predict the effects of such an undertaking and what it would cost the country. The mission is codenamed Project A-119 and is highly classified. In order for it to be successful, Rifle needs the best of the best. He recruits Gerard Kuiper, a planetary science professor at the University of Chicago, whose contributions to astronomy would later lead to part of space just outside of our solar system, consisting of billions of comets, asteroids, and other icy objects to be named the Kuiper Belt. But Kuiper doesn't come alone. He's been working with a young astrophysicist that shows real promise. At the time Rifle approached him, Kuiper had been advising a young scientist working on his dissertation. This young scientist was none other than Carl Sagan. He's recruited to work on the Project A-119 team. Sagan would later become a household name as one of the greatest proponents of bringing science to the general public in the world. He's tasked with figuring out what would happened to the irradiated dust that would be ejected into space if the United States detonated a nuke on the moon. Now that Rifle has put his team together, everyone gets to work. They cram numbers and double-check calculations in the lab day and night to model what it would take to detonate a nuke on the moon. More importantly, they figure out what the repercussions of such an action would be. Weeks of sleepless nights and strenuous days go by before a final report is completed. Rifle publishes the report and titles it "A Study of Lunar Research Flights," although a more apt title might have been "How to Nuke the Moon and What'll Happen." The research team has concluded that since the moon lacks an atmosphere, several key events will not occur. The first is that there will be no mushroom cloud from the explosion. Instead, once the nuke is detonated, it'll kick tons of dust and debris straight up into the vacuum of space. It would be more of a pillar than a mushroom cloud. However, the heads of the Air Force are pleased to hear that the flash upon detonation would still be visible from the Earth. "What's the point of nuking the moon if no one can see that you did it?" the government wondered. The whole point of the mission is to show the world that the United States has a presence in space. It's also to boost the morale of the country who feels that the U.S. is falling behind the Soviets. And since they're at war, even if it is a cold one, the United States must show their strength and ability to outdo anything the Soviets can. At the conclusion of the report, Rifle and the team make some suggestions. Since they are all scientists, they can't help but add some experiments to the blowing up the moon plan. They recommend sending up scientific instruments before the nuclear warhead and landing them on a location where data can be collected. When the nuke goes off, it'll send seismic waves through the moon's crust and mantle. The waves can be recorded and analyzed. The data collected this way would allow scientists to better understand the composition of the moon and what its internal layers consist of. However, the team also concludes that there are some definite problems with nuking the moon. First and foremost, it'll be incredibly expensive. To be fair, no price tag is too big if it means beating the Soviets to something. This is because it would boost morale and make people around the world cower in fear at America's might. But Rifle and his team also conduct some preliminary research on how the public will feel about the United States nuking the moon. They find that not everyone is as excited about the idea as the U.S. Air Force is. After the devastation that the nuclear bombs caused at the end of World War II in Japan, nukes became a real concern for the average citizen. Everyone now knew that if a nuke goes off in their vicinity, they would most likely not be able to escape its blast. It also doesn't help that the Soviet Union and the United States have continued to improve on the deadly weapons and make them more and more powerful. The research team concludes that the general public is not prepared for the nuking of the moon, and it could create a negative reaction instead of a positive one. There's also another problem with the plan. If the United States successfully blows up a nuclear bomb on the moon, the Soviets will have to do the same. Not only that, but they'll have to one-up their adversary, which means that an even larger nuke might be sent to the moon by the communist regime. This would continue to escalate until the two nations either blew up the moon or each other. It could also lead to the lunar surface becoming a radioactive wasteland. At this point in 1957, no one has ever been to the moon, so who knows what damage could be caused if the nuke was detonated there. In fact, as far as anyone knew, there may be life hidden in the warm pockets on the lunar surface. It's unlikely, but more research needs to be done before humans irradiate the space rock. Rifle and his team informs the Air Force that if nuclear bombing of the moon gets out of hand, it will be unsafe to send any astronauts in the future since the radiation levels will be too high. The conclusion of Project A-119 is that nuking the moon is just not worth it, says Leonard Rifle. The generals in the room rifle through the documents in front of them, grumbling their discontent. It seems as if some of them really wanted to blow up the moon, even if it was just for fun. "We don't know enough about the moon to warrant destroying it yet," Rifle continues. "Are there important resources on the lunar surface? Could we colonize the moon someday? Is there hidden alien life there? We just don't know, and nuking the moon could jeopardize discovering all of that." The generals close their folders and push them toward the middle of the table. "Very well," says one of the Air Force generals a little somberly. "We won't nuke the moon." "Thank you," responds Rifle. Something else to keep in mind: the United States record with successfully launching missiles into space without exploding them is not great. If you attach a nuclear warhead to the top of one of those missiles and something goes wrong, you will inadvertently be detonating a nuclear bomb on United States soil. The repercussions of such a tragedy would be disastrous. The Air Force generals all agree. All of these valid concerns eventually lead the United States government to scrapping Project A-119. Sending a nuke to the moon and detonating it was something that the world was not ready for. And the Soviets agreed. They also gave up their plans to nuke the moon, most likely because the idea of something going wrong and a nuclear warhead detonation within the USSR was not something the communist leadership wanted. And it's probably for the best that all of this was put to a stop, because even though Project A-119 never got off the ground, the other nuclear missions did, with disastrous consequences. On June 20, 1962, the first Starfish Prime mission was launched to detonate a nuclear warhead at high altitudes. The results were catastrophic. The missile encountered problems mid-flight and detonated at a lower altitude than planned. This sent radioactive particles raining down in the Pacific Ocean. Even with this disaster, the United States tried again, and on July 9, 1962, managed to detonate a nuke in space. The warhead went off 250 miles above the Pacific Ocean, at which point the electromagnetic pulse caused streetlights, telephone lines, and other electronic devices to go dead across the state of Hawaii. Things were clearly starting to get out of hand. In 1963, partial test ban treaty prohibited the testing of nuclear weapons in outer space, in the atmosphere, or underwater. And just to make sure no one did anything crazy, like, say, try to blow up the moon, in 1967 the Outer Space Treaty was signed, which included a provision that stated nuclear weapons could not be deployed or used in space in any manner. It also stated that the moon was to be used for science and exploration missions only. Basically, the treaty said, leave the moon alone and stop trying to blow it up. Thanks again to our sponsor, Conflict of Nations, the free online PvP strategy game set in a modern global warfare. Get a special gift of 13,000 gold and 1 month of premium subscription for free by using the link. It's only available for 30 days, so don't wait. Download Conflict of Nations and start fighting your way to victory right now. Now watch what would happen if we detonated a nuke in space, or check out what to do if there's a nuclear explosion.